This evening on The Rock Newman Show, sworn in on January the 2nd, 2015, Muriel Bowser is the 7th elected mayor of Washington, D.C. She joins us today to discuss taking charge at a time of whirlwind change, from skyrocketing real estate prices to record level violence in a city that is becoming more and more economically polarized. That's coming up right now on The Rock Newman Show. Welcome to The Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University, located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. A native Washingtonian, D.C.'s Mayor Muriel Bowser knows her city well. She earned a graduate degree from American University and served as Ward 4 council member from 2007 until she was elected mayor. She joins us now. Thank you so much.
Hey, Rock.
Welcome to the Rock Newman Show.
My pleasure.
You know, I've had a relationship with all of the mayors who've sat in the seat where you now sit. And at one time or the other, it's always been within a month or so after they've been elected. I always have an opportunity to ask them the question, now you ran and you campaigned real hard for this job. Are you sure you really wanted it?
Yes.
Because they get in office.
Yes.
And see what a daunting task it is to run this city with its myriad of influences from the federal government, for the just the number of challenges that you face from day one.
Yes. Well, in my first month in office, there was a really significant accident on the metro. It snowed, I think, every week. And shortly thereafter, a Republican congressman from Utah threatened to throw me in jail because
yes.
I wanted to stand up for a law that D.C. residents voted for.
Mm-hmm.
So, yes, in the first month, immediately you're like, ah, you're the mayor. I have to tell you, 10 months later, I couldn't be happier or prouder of the work that we've done for the residents of Washington.
You know, I must take a personal liberty to go back.
Yes.
Because when you stood very firmly on your feet, when the as you say, the citizens of the District of Columbia had voted for something.
Yes.
And you were supporting and representing your constituency.
Yes.
You stood up.
Yes.
And you were threatened to be put in jail, and basically, you didn't use any foul language or anything, but there was a message there that was saying, you know, we're free.
Right.
We're free.
Right.
We don't have statehood.
Right.
But we are free, and I'm going to stand by this. And I saw a sense of support for you at that time and people coalescing around you. That was a wonderful demonstration of strength.
Well, thank you. And it was, I have to tell you, I went to the office that day, and I joke about it, but I wasn't really joking, because I decided to wear my comfortable clothes. So I had on a green jacket and some comfortable flat shoes and all that, because about probably 14 months before that, they did put me in jail for standing up for D.C. residents.
Mm-hmm.
And I decided if I was going to go that day, at least I would be comfortable.
Okay. Well, so now, so you've taken on an extremely tough job.
Yes.
Something that I've often said might be the most difficult, one of the most difficult jobs in all of America. Let's go back, though, to when you were a little girl.
Okay.
I'm curious as to what Muriel Bowser's childhood dreams were. What did you want to be when you grew up?
Well, you know, I think I have had a pretty typical childhood. Mm-hmm. in Washington. I grew up in a great middle-class, working-class neighborhood in Ward 5. My parents worked in the government. I was the youngest of five kids. My parents taught us to go to church, help out around the house, but most importantly, go to school and stay focused on school. So that was kind of how I grew up. I grew up in the community doing grassroots work with my dad, who was an ANC commissioner. I knew I loved politics. I knew I loved government. I didn't think that, hey, one day I'm going to run for mayor. But it became pretty clear to me fast that the best way to change things in D.C. was to get elected. So I started off as the ANC commissioner. I had the privilege of serving Ward 4 on the council for almost 8 years, and now I get to be mayor of my hometown.
You're mayor of a hometown of a population that's changing rapidly. Perhaps there is no greater concern than what kind of service is going to be provided for children who are coming through the educational process. So can you talk to us about, you know, I saw a billboard not long ago, and I frankly don't know if it was correct or not.
Okay.
But there was a blaring print on it that said 57% of high school students in Washington, D.C. Don't finish. So I don't know if that was accurate or not, but that's an alarming number if it's anywhere close to that. So the question would be, what is happening and what are you doing, what is your administration doing to make sure that Washington, D.C. schools become the best in the world?
Well, Rock, that number may have been correct in 2006 and 2007, before this city embarked on one of the most robust school reform initiatives anywhere in the country. We achieved a single line of accountability in our schools. So the mayor controls the schools, hires the chancellor, works with the council to make sure our schools have the resources that they need. We also have a diversity of choices in our schools, two very robust sectors of public education that are working hand in hand together. So we're not anywhere near where we have to be with schools, but we've come a long way from 2007. Two of the biggest numbers I refer to are the number of parents who are now choosing public schools in the District of Columbia. I don't have to tell you, people fled this city in the 70s and 80s and 90s because they were not confident in schools. When families now see that our city is safer, that we have great parks, we have great transportation, and our schools are improving, and the elected officials are standing behind that reform, then they have confidence in sending their kids to school. One area that we know that we have to stay focused on are our boys, a population of our students who haven't moved as quickly as others.
There was a polarizing figure, to say the least, that was the chancellor here at one point. That was Michelle Rhee.
Yes.
And her understudy was Kaya Henderson.
She might like to be called deputy.
Deputy, okay. And there was some controversy when someone who served time and supported Michelle Rhee came in. It seems as if, by and large, she's getting some high marks in terms of impacting in a very positive way the educational process.
Well, Rock, I can tell you, when I go across the country, we are the envy of many school districts, and I am the envy of many mayors, because mostly we have achieved mayoral control, so the mayor can hire and fire the chancellor of schools. But we have also have sustained leadership. So think what you will about Michelle Rhee. She got a lot of very important hard stuff done early, and we have been able to sustain leadership through Kaya Henderson for that whole period of time. So that's, you know, we're working on three mayors that have sustained and stood behind school reform. And that's important. What happens when you change political leaders and you change chancellors every time, or you change the direction? The system doesn't have a chance to catch up, and you don't have a chance for sustained reform. We finally have that in Washington, D.C., and it's very important.
Ms. Mayor, let me ask this, because there seems to have been traditionally a Hatfield and McCoy's relationship between the school chancellor or whoever, superintendent of schools or whatever, and the teachers and the teachers' union. Is there something, some kind of way that you can take an initiative, Do you have any that bring those two sides closer together? Because ultimately, I think they both have the goal of the students at heart.
Right.
Truly, right. But it seems as if they fight so often and never come together.
Well,
Can we ever bridge that gap?
Well, it's a relationship that has a little antagonism by definition, right? Okay. So management and labor come together, negotiate different issues. So there's a little healthy tension in that relationship, just definitionally. But my job as mayor is to support our employees and make sure they have the resources and tools that they need to deliver services, and make sure that my managers can say, this is what we need to get done. And what's going to be the best relationship to get there. Quite frankly, my approach to all of the union leaders is to work honestly and directly. And I'm known for my candor. I'll tell you, this is what we need, and I'm going to listen to what you need and try to meet in the middle. And I'm really proud of the investments we've been able to make in our in labor. Just in our first year alone, we've been able to invest in an initiative that's been throughout this, you know, the government for, I think, since Tony Williams, in right-sizing our compensation levels in the district. So we're looking at that and investing in it. We've also been able to make sure some long-standing issues with some of our unions have been resolved, like our firefighters that we had probably a 10-year dispute with that has now been resolved. We also said, I said when I came in office, when we had a $190 million operating gap, that we're not going to balance that on the backs of our workers. So all of our workers got their regular increase this year. We didn't talk about furloughing any employees. We looked at how we could be more efficient. And that's the same approach that we'll take with working with our teachers. They're going to come to the table now with us to negotiate a new contract. We think they have a great contract that awards people for great service. And so now we have among the highest paid teachers anywhere in the nation. And so I can tell you it's working, because it used to be that the chancellor likes to tell this story. When she first started working with DCPS as a consultant, before she was even on staff, we couldn't hire enough teachers and principals at the beginning of the year.
Yeah.
Frequently, we started every year still hiring.
Yeah.
Now we're finished hiring in August.
Mm-hmm.
So that tells you it's a good place to work. Yeah. It's a good place to teach.
Yeah. The last thing before we get off of education, our viewing audience may not know this because it's not necessarily something that the TV station WHUT sits and touts all the time.
Sure.
But as a lover of Howard University
Yes.
and all the good that it does, I'm going to take the liberty to say something about the mission of WHUT Television.
Okay.
And it says it's the nation's only public broadcasting television station owned and operated by a historically black university. It is to deliver educational, entertaining, intellectually stimulating, multicultural, and intergenerational programming to the public in the Metro DC region. To that end, WHUT has focused its efforts for the past several years to serve our most valuable assets, our kids, in the underserved community.
Yes.
And there is an alliance, a partnership of sorts, with DC Public Schools.
Good.
And you know, I become aware in doing what I do here, for example, of this station going out into the neighborhood like Woodland Terrace.
Mm.
When people think of Woodland Terrace, they think of violence. They think of some killings that have happened over there, and this station is a part of that, and your administration has embraced that.
Absolutely. Well, I certainly am a lover of Howard University as well, and Howard's mission that has been so focused on educating people right here in the heart of Washington, D.C., every aspect from communications to business to science and medicine and in the arts. And I just am very committed to Howard's success here in Washington, and have so loved working with Dr. Frederick.
Yeah. Absolutely,
yes.
Some new energy there that we all love. Okay, you recently let's talk about a couple things here.
Sure.
You were one of the greatest criticisms that you've had to endure has had something to do with a PAC. I forget the name of the PAC, but the PAC was established, and your supporters have said that PAC was established, and in part what it did is it allowed or helped and supported the city government to accomplish things that might not be able to be accomplished through the regular legislative process, okay, and administrative process. Mm-hmm. And that's what your supporters have said, and your detractors have said that PAC was a pay-for-play playground where your supporters donated and were given favorable treatment. For our viewing audience out there who maybe don't know or have taken one side or the other, what say you?
Well, I don't think anybody has said anybody has gotten favorable treatment. They may insinuate or say that it could happen, but nobody has said that because that simply hasn't happened. I think you know, Rock, you get all around the country, and you know that PACs, political action committees, exist at every level of government, every city, every state, for governors, congresspeople, mayors. Mm-hmm. So the existence of a PAC really is nothing new. I think the message of the PAC could have been a little bit more clear. Mm-hmm. So it just didn't seem like a raw political entity. Mm-hmm. But something that could really focus, just like PACs do, on helping office holders with an agenda. And we have a tough agenda. Mm-hmm. It's not easy saying you're going to end homelessness. It's not right. easy taking on record high rents, mm-hmm. and saying that the government should carve out $100 million for affordable housing. Those things aren't easy. But at the same time, we've built a great record in this city as mayor and before when I was the council member, and I don't need anything distracting me from the hard work. Mm-hmm. And so we've made a hard pivot away from a focus on a PAC, and we're going to just stay focused on our agenda from the inside.
And while that when that pivot was made was during a time when you were on an international mission,
yes.
to China.
Yes.
So talk to us about your trip to China.
Sure.
How was that initiated? What was it for, and what do you feel you accomplished?
I think it was great. So one thing that I promised as a candidate for mayor, and we will deliver on in our time in office, is that D.C. Should not just be the parochial D.C. of our neighborhoods that we all know and love. That's great, mm-hmm. but we need to be leaders in the region. We need to be leaders in the nation, and we need to increase our footprint around the world. And I've been very focused on that. I have to tell you, I've been well received. Mm-hmm. And so when the mayor of Washington goes to China, by the way, it is our number one visiting nation. So the when we look at who comes to visit Washington as tourists, mm-hmm. the number one visiting nation is China.
Is that right?
It
okay.
is.
Okay.
So our mission was both diplomatic and mm-hmm. economic. And so I visited with the mayor of Beijing. Mm-hmm. I visited with officials in Shanghai. I visited with businesses. And we hosted two forums, first ever forums, that focused on Chinese investors and four economic development projects in Washington, D.C. The former Mayor Gray invested in the China Center, who are our representatives in China. Mm-hmm. And we're building on that relationship as well to make sure that foreign investment dollars are finding D.C. projects. So the idea, somebody said, a critic said, we don't need any of that money. Mm. Well, that's the most absurd thing I've ever heard. Mm-hmm. Because the fact is, we have big projects in D.C.
Right.
that continue to need investment. Now, mm-hmm. one thing that we've been able to accomplish this year, and we'll be able to deliver on in the next couple of years, is a $55 million investment in Ward 8. That will kickstart the development of St. Elizabeth's, mm-hmm. which is huge for residents of Ward 8. Mm-hmm. It will create jobs, it will create housing, but more importantly, it's going to finally allow us to activate the entire development at St. Elizabeth's. So we're very excited about the Wizards.
I was going to ask you about that a little further in mm-hmm. the interview, but since you've brought it up, mm-hmm. would you share with us, you know, the vision, what it is anticipated, when what's the goal of the work and the project underway at St. Elizabeth?
Sure. So, you know, we have about 100 acres at St. Elizabeth's,
yeah.
and it's been hard to develop. I think Mayor Gray focused on it a lot, but we never secured an anchor tenant. You know, when you look at all these big developments, there's one anchor,
sure.
whether it's an employer or a retailer, it's an anchor that goes in first, that sends the signal to everybody else that this is a safe place to invest, it's happening, and you should be here.
Right.
Well, we were missing that at St. Elizabeth's. And we worked very hard to get it. We knew that the Washington Wizards were looking for their practice facility. They toyed with some ideas around the city, and they frankly in their outer suburbs. But we wanted them to stay in Washington. I was willing to invest in them staying in Washington if it helped us in Ward 8. And we came to a great agreement, and we're working on finalizing that agreement now.
To those who again, criticize that, because there are those there are those who walked in and said, hey, $55 million for a professional team and to someone like Ted Leonsis, who's a gazillionaire, the money could have been much better spent somewhere else. So how, what do you say to those people, and how do you justify that that was quite a bit of funds to be expended to attract them? So. Why is the, makes it a value?
You, what I tell people all the time is, why shouldn't Ward 8 get an investment? We've invested in every other ward. We've put up incentive dollars in every other place. Now that it's Ward 8's turn, we all need to stand up and make that investment in Ward 8 as well. And so part of our economic development strategy is to continue to use incentives where they make sense. And I challenge my team, I call my economic development team the big deal team. So the big deal team has to tell me how it's gonna get us more jobs, how it's gonna spread prosperity to all 8 wards, and what's the long-term play? Long-term, and you know, you have to invest in jobs. And the fact is, in cities, $15 billion we're going to spend this year. You have to invest in schools and public safety and neighborhoods and in the economic development projects that will keep the city growing.
Which brings me absolutely to my next point. And that is something that is has been historically so incredibly difficult to manage. And that is big development and growth and increasing the tax revenue base while maintaining a cultural identity, gentrification, the G, that four-letter word, the G word, gentrification. What are your programs and policies and initiatives that on the one hand will allow for that growth, but on the other hand, keep the cultural identity? And when we say that, by and large, Washington, D.C. is long-term referred to as Chocolate City and has been losing many of its lower-income African-American citizens.
Right.
So how do you prevent that from happening? How do you reconcile those two? I know it's a tough job. You're the mayor.
Right, it is a tough job.
Yeah.
So you have to hit it from two ways, and our approach has been the government has to stand in the breach where it can. So no mayor is going to be able to tell you that they can make the rents lower. Or no mayor is going to tell you they don't want people and businesses moving here, which creates higher demand for housing and higher prices. Nobody's going to tell you that. But what we do say is that the government has a role to stand it where it can. And that $100 million that I want to invest every year in creating and preserving housing is going to help us using our public land. So anytime there's a development project where we want to use our public land, we have to insist and subsidize the affordable housing there. So those are all programs. I created a housing preservation strike force, for example, that's looking at 8,000 vulnerable units. We have to stay focused on our public housing units and how we transform them in a way that keeps people in Washington.
When you say 8,000 vulnerable units, that focus on 8,000, what do you mean by that?
I mean, we have all over the city, Rock, places where there have been some kind of tax credit that has kept the rents below market rate. And those tax credits have an expiration period, and we're coming up on them over the next 10 years
so
in Washington.
So the people that are investing the money, they get certain tax credits for allowing those long-term citizens to be able to stay there at affordable prices.
They have gotten those tax credits over the years, and many have been 20 years, 15 years, at a time where it was different when you were a housing provider in Washington, where having a federal tax credit was more stable than going out to the market. That has changed. And so some of those property owners will be making decisions about what to do with those buildings. And so we don't have a good answer right now as a city, because some of these buildings, downtown buildings, one building could be cost $70 million. So I put together a group of real estate folks, tenant advocates, government people to really look at the scope of the problem to see what role the government can have in changing it.
Okay. So we touch on gentrification, we touch on affordable housing. Certainly not in any particular order, but in Washington, D.C., the nation's capital, when you drive around and you see folks living on the street, you see the complaints of people being moved from a particular area where they were housing themselves overnight, the homeless problem in Washington, D.C. I remember a comment that Mayor Barry made, former Mayor Barry, Mayor for Life, Mayor Barry, that he made, that as much as he was a progressive-minded person, then this was in private at one point, him saying, I don't know if this homeless situation is ever going to be able to be fixed and handled. So for someone, you know, sort of as progressive and as optimistic as he was, to make that comment, I ask you, what are we going to do?
Well, it's hard. It is a hard job, but it is solvable in my view. And we have laid out a plan that will get us to ending homelessness for veterans, for example, this year. And so when I say that, I mean anybody can have an emergency. And so we want to make sure if you experience homelessness that it's rare, first of all, that it's a brief period of time, and that it's non-recurring, so you won't become homeless again. And so we have adopted an approach called Housing First. So no matter how bad your situation is, whether you have mental illness or drug addiction or just extended joblessness, the idea is to get you in stable housing and then work with you with services to deal with those other issues. So that's our approach. We've also taken on a tough problem of closing a large, ineffective family shelter, DC General, and how we're going to provide emergency housing for up to 280 families across the city, not warehoused at DC General, where we don't think it's an effective or safe way to deliver services to those
families. Sometimes there are, you know, maybe 500-600 people, because you say 280 families, I mean, you know, that are sheltered at DC General. So it seems that the challenge is that people are compassionate, except they want to say, not in my neighborhood.
Yes.
So what might be the mechanism or the vehicle that would be able to close a DC General and house on any given night, especially during the time when it's cold, 500 or 600 people in other places? Is the idea to distribute those people equally amongst the wards, or what is the plan?
The idea is to have smaller shelters of no more than 50 units. That way we think that families can have that safe landing spot, get services, and get help getting into permanent housing in a shorter period of time. As you know, it won't be easy. We spent a lot of months really evaluating sites, and we hope to send to the council real soon a set of sites that will support families, that will enhance the neighborhoods that they're in and not detract from neighborhoods, but also be close to transportation, close to employment and services.
Do you know if your team looked at the model in Salt Lake City?
Yes, to Housing First. The idea of a lot of cities that have been able to better combat homelessness is they really looked at what the true cost of homelessness is. So having people in shelter, having people on the street, they use more services and they're not getting helped. And so it's cheaper to invest in affordable housing and permanent supportive housing where it's needed.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk about what has been an alarming increase in violence and homicides.
Yeah.
A couple of things. What do you, as the, CEO, what do you attribute the reason being for these spikes? And what are you and your team, the police chief doing to try to combat this increase in violence?
Right. I don't think a single big city mayor or police chief or federal government, justice, or FBI has determined a single reason for the spike. And it is almost unexplainable why we've seen it in cities across the United States. Mm-hmm. And in cities where other crime has been flat, including ours. Crime has been flat on most of our categories except violence. Violent, involving a gun. And so we have been very focused, and not just now, but starting probably as early as April, on what's going on in our neighborhoods. How are we removing illegal guns from neighborhoods? How are we working with people who have been repeat violent offenders and most likely to continue to commit these types of crimes, and getting them off our streets. Also working with our prosecutors to make sure when our police are making these arrests that people are actually seeing justice. And that's been important. Our communities have responded. They're working hand in hand with officers to make the streets safer. They're calling in tip lines about illegal guns, which we want to work really hard to get out of the streets. But what we know, Rock, is that this is not a problem that you arrest your way out of.
Yeah.
That we want to prevent people from making really bad decisions, from hurting somebody else, or becoming a victim themselves. So we also have a strategy of really getting a grassroots effort to work with people who know the communities really well, mm-hmm. know the young people who may find themselves in trouble. And I shouldn't just say young people, mm-hmm. this is all ages involved here. And so just in the next week or so, we're gonna announce part of our Safer, Stronger package of reforms was to put some grassroots programs to support community organizations or even individuals mm-hmm. Through many grants mm-hmm. that will help us get people in a better situation.
And so we talk about the violence, the increased violence, and obviously, connected to that is policing.
Mm-hmm.
And there's, one of the prominent things in the news today
yes.
is the situation, the horrible situation that just happened a year or so ago in
mm-hmm.
Chicago,
mm-hmm.
where, this kid was shot 16 times, he was gunned down, and it's what seems to be a police culture that covered up what really happened
yep.
there. So my question with that as a backdrop is, do you have any initiatives underway to sensitize police officers and to try to break, folks say, hey, all police officers are not bad. And I think that's a very good assumption.
Absolutely.
that's a reality. And then they say, okay, but where are the good ones when the bad ones misbehave? So that there still is a culture there of a code of silence, of protecting,
right.
if you will. So my question is, in order to make your department the best, do you have any initiatives underway which address that?
Yeah, so we're going to bake it into the infrastructure. So culture sometimes changes slowly, but mm-hmm. we can change the infrastructure right away. And so in my budget back in April, I put in $5 million so that we could outfit every police officer on the beat, every beat officer in D.C. with a body camera.
Mm-hmm.
We got that initiative funded. The council just approved the rules that determine access to the footage.
I was going to ask you, because there was some controversy about that,
as yes.
to when it's going to be turned on and when it's not going to be turned on. Can you explain that?
Well, it's going to be turned on with any interaction that a police officer has. Mm-hmm. And so we were very, very intent on both having accountability but also privacy. Mm-hmm. And so the rules, I think that we're going to be very proud of the program that we have. It'll be the most robust anywhere in the nation. And so basically any footage that's captured in public is available to all the parties involved and can be available to the press. We were very intent on making sure though that if somebody called the police into their home, that they could be assured of privacy. And mm-hmm. so that footage has a different process.
Mm-hmm. What's the relationship, what has been the recent relationship, and what do you foresee it being in your dealings with Capitol Hill? Mm-hmm. With the leaders down on Capitol Hill. And, well, let me have you respond to that.
Well, we have in our administration, Rock, taken a different approach to our federal and regional affairs. So I created an office for federal and regional affairs. So I have a senior advisor who oversees that office. The mayor never really had that type of operation. Mm-hmm. So we only relied on the very good work of our delegate. Mm-hmm. And she has done a yeoman's job at getting that done.
Yes.
And so she certainly has her point of view in the things that she has to get done for us on the Hill. Now, every mayor and governor, however, has a operation that works, that represents the executive mm-hmm. on the Hill. Mm-hmm. We had, and I became convinced of this because the mayor of New York City, I think, had like 15 people down in Washington working the Hill and working the federal government agencies every day for New York City. Mm-hmm. And we didn't have any. Mm-hmm. So I created this office, and their focus is on our relationships on the Hill. Now, we have a different environment. We have a new speaker, and I will get in to see them when he gets settled down. I'll pay him a visit, just like I did with Speaker Boehner. So my approach has been, and Eleanor has been instructive in this, is don't assume that the Republicans are going to be against us. Mm-hmm. We have to work with them, and mm-hmm. we have to have a working relationship with them. And so I intend to go put, so he can put faces and names together and know what we're about in D.C.
Mm-hmm. And while we're talking on that subject, any progress or hope for anywhere in the near future for statehood for Washington, D.C.?
Well, I am optimistic, actually, in that way, but I don't think that we can approach it the way that we always have. Mm-hmm. So the idea of something happening, this is how we could do with statehood. Somebody will make us mad and it'll be a fever pitch of activity, and then it goes away. Mm-hmm. Somebody will do something else and there was another, and then it goes away. Yeah. So we are strategizing now on a different approach to call the question about the legality of D.C. residents not being represented, mm-hmm. American taxpaying mm-hmm. citizens mm-hmm. not being represented in Congress.
Taxation without representation is tyranny, always was, and always will be.
Uh-huh.
Statehood for D.C.
That's right.
We could talk about every one of your departments. Just learned recently that your Office of Television and Cable, you combined, sort of one. Tell us about that.
So we have, apropos that we're in a studio, so we have a TV station too, mm-hmm. DC TV, mm-hmm. and we also have an office of, we called it Motion Pictures.
Yes.
And the Motion Picture office was really focused on how we bring more movie business into the district. Mm-hmm. And our cable television office was focused on a number of things, including regulating the cable franchise in D.C., but also putting on our public television, the mayor's channel, the council's channel, our education channels, and getting information out to the public. We were able to recruit just a fantastic executive to lead the Motion Picture office. Mm-hmm. And as I was thinking about it, I've had this thought for a while mm-hmm. before I was mayor, that wouldn't it be great if we kind of combine those forces mm-hmm. so that we had a more robust effort that was focused on film, on television, but also making D.C. more of an entertainment capital. Mm-hmm. Now, you know the entertainment business well, and you know everything that this city has to offer. We're not getting our fair share.
Yeah.
or not. We don't get our fair share of movies. We don't get our fair share of TV. We don't get our fair share of music production, of the fight game. We don't get our fair share. And we have the fan base. We have the facilities. Now we need the vision.
Little Birdie just told me that a fairly major movie might be doing some of its filming here.
Yes, and that's just going to be the first of many.
Are you able to publicly speak
about
that?
Yes, one of the Bourne movies, in the Bourne series, they're filming in D.C. this week. And so, you know, we want to really acknowledge the great work of the film. The Office of Film, Television, and Entertainment is led by Angie Gates, who's been long time executive, and most recently at the Warner Theater, and we're great to have her on board.
Okay, let's go to talk about a little bit of the development that is happening, which is exciting. First of all, let's go to Southwest, the Southwest waterfront. Where the wharf is, and you know, long-term establishments down there, the Channel Inn, folks from way back in the day used to go hang out, and now it is becoming something extraordinary.
It will be.
Tell us all about what's happening with that project there on the waterfront.
Well, I think you know this has probably been in the works for about 10 years. And it was interesting. I was there with Eleanor for one of their groundbreaking sort of celebrations, and they were all trying to figure out what they were going to call it, what the project was going to be called. And Eleanor says, oh, it's the Wharf. And they were all like, oh, that's a great name. We should call it that. And she and I are looking at each other like, it is what it's called. So it was just kind of a demonstration to me that we have to work, to your point, to work very hard to make sure that as we grow, as we make new investments, that we never forget these neighborhoods and what they've meant to us. It's always been the Wharf to me, and it's going to be the Wharf in the future. But we'll see. Speaking of things that we don't have our fair share of, and that's great waterfront property. And we have two great rivers on the Potomac and on the Anacostia. And when you go to other cities, you see that there's an enlivened waterfront. We're going to have that opportunity. So in addition to what we have in Georgetown, we're going to have at the Wharf, and like we have further down in Southwest, we'll be able to have an enlivened waterfront, which means so much to a world-class city.
Now, I saw some renderings and saw some promotional material, but the group down there, Hoffman, that is, I guess, the lead, the lead developer. And, you know, I saw one, which obviously it was a rendition of a large condo that overlooks the Potomac River. It was something beyond spectacular. And its price point was probably going to be somewhere around $3.5 to $4 million. And that's great and wonderful. The question is, would any of the lower or moderate income individuals, is there anything being designed where they might be able to participate in all of that wonderfulness also?
Right, so their below market rate units going to be there too. Just like at City Center, which is also kind of a luxury development where there are some high cost units, they're also below market rate units there, and that will be the case at the Wharf too. So when I mentioned to you, when we have public land, we can leverage those high value units to get lower value units. And we have it set in the law now that if there's a public land deal close to Metro, it has to be 30% of the units have to be below market rate. And so when you see the high end units, they're basically subsidized.
And so folks who just might not understand that, that's your policy.
That's our policy.
To be able to maintain and to keep people in the city who otherwise, as far as price points are concerned, would have to leave.
It is our policy, but it's not without a cost. And so that's why I always like to mention that, because sometimes people will say, well, why did you sell that property to that developer for below the price, for a low price? And I said, I sold it at that price so that I can get this many millions of dollars worth of affordable housing. And so for every one of those projects, if they sold all of those units for $5 million, they will make this much money. But I'm telling them, you can't sell all of them for that. You have to sell some of them below market rate. And so the difference in the prices helps us support the lower cost units.
A friend of mine, his name is Andy Shalal.
I know him.
And Andy Shalal had recently told me that he is committed, and it seems to be the deal is in the works for a Bus Boys and Poets on Martin Luther King Avenue.
Yes.
Now, when you say getting an anchor tenant, yes, it seems as if part of what has happened, it seems as if Andy has, you know, built a franchise out of going into the not quite yet ready neighborhoods, becoming an anchor of sort, or certainly an attraction of sort. And every time he's done that, you've seen, you know, a draft and substantial development around it. One, can you share anything as to whether or not that's solid and going to happen there? And talk to us about what's going on in, you talked to us about St. Elizabeth,
sure,
but a little further up Martin Luther King Avenue and Good Hope Road.
Yes.
What's going on over there?
Well, we have part of the first projects that we asked the development community to look at were at Martin Luther King and Good Hope Road, because the city owns a lot of property there, mm-hmm, has owned it for years, mm-hmm, and has done nothing with it. And quite frankly, I'm tired of that.
Yeah.
And we have to get something going there. So during our March Madness, we put out a request, and now we're evaluating proposals to see if we can partner with somebody to get something going there. But Andy has a model, mm-hmm, that works.
Yeah.
And he knows how it works. He knows where it can work. Mm-hmm. He hires DC residents, mm-hmm, and he's committed to the city. And so I know that he has a lease with a property owner on Martin Luther King, mm-hmm, and I'm interested in making it happen.
I find that to be exciting.
Because it's very exciting.
You know, because I mean, if it stands to tradition, quickly after they've gone into an area, it's moved up dramatically.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. And so the other thing is, you may know this, but I opened an office right off of Martin Luther King Avenue at, mm-hmm, Shannon Place. Mm-hmm. That's where our deputy mayor for greater economic opportunity works. And so we have a great suite there. And so more and more D.C. government officials and workers are working from Shannon Place. We're encouraging neighbors in Ward 7 and 8 who don't want to go all the way downtown for city services, mm-hmm, to go right to Shannon Place. But one thing that they've found in working there is that they need more places to go out for lunch,
yep,
and coffee. Yep. And so the more there are some existing businesses on MLK now, the more businesses that go, the more come.
Mm-hmm.
When they see somebody like Andy Shalal go in, it signals to the rest of the restaurant and retail community that this is a good and safe place to invest your money, mm-hmm, and take a chance.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of taking a chance, there's another initiative that's called DC Connect, mm-hmm, at Home.
Yeah.
Said that right. And it is about the being able to allow residents in the lower economic areas to be able to be connected to the internet. And
yes,
it's something else that Howard and WHUT has participated
good
in. And
good. I think this is the program you're talking about that our housing authority is working on. Mm-hmm. And I was at an event recently where we announced it with federal government representatives and private sector representatives to connect more people to the internet.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have to tell you that the number of people, I forget the statistic now, but it's something like 80% of people seeking jobs are doing so over the internet.
Mm-hmm.
So, and that's probably because 80% of the jobs are being made available only on online applications.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're not connected, if you don't have basic skills about how to use the computer, you're putting yourself at a distinct disadvantage. Now, it's true, we have internet connections in our rec centers and libraries. I also just announced a new mobile computer lab that we're sending out to communities. But we want people to be able to have low-cost access at home.
Your positive attitude and your enthusiasm for what you're doing is very contagious.
Oh, thank you.
With that being said, let me ask you if you would reflect, what's the most difficult aspect of the job that you're doing?
Well, I will tell you, probably the most difficult is that you have to make difficult decisions in this job. And you know how it is when you make decisions. You'll make some people happy, mm-hmm, and some people won't be happy.
Mm-hmm.
So I want everybody to be happy,
yeah,
but that's impossible,
mm-hmm,
sometimes. So I think that's hard. And having to, it is when you're the mayor, you have to fight hard for the things that you believe in, and sometimes you have to fight every day. Mm-hmm. And so I think that's been challenging. But the thing that I'm most concerned about from a leading the government standpoint is making sure we get ahead of the crime in the city. Mm-hmm. Now, certainly I grew up in a time in Washington where we had over 400 homicides.
Mm-hmm.
400.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
In a
capital.
City of our size.
Yes.
So we're nowhere near those bad old days of Washington. So when I hear people saying we have record crime, fact is we're nowhere near record crime in Washington. But anytime a family, a community suffers a homicide, is a jolt to their safety.
Yeah.
Anytime a neighbor is fearful of being robbed, it's a jolt to their feeling of safety. And so we're gonna do everything that we can, not only to push crime down, but make sure people feel safer in Washington. So that's troubled me, but I'm very confident in our leadership and all the strategies and a partnership with the council of the district who will make sure that they're supporting the things that we ask for to make D.C. safer.
As a D.C. homegirl,
yep.
I watched your your parents
mm-hmm.
sort of beaming as you were being sworn in.
Thank you.
And just on a personal note, so now their daughter is leading the city, but in leading the city, it doesn't matter if you do everything right.
Right.
You're gonna get a whole lot of criticism.
Right, right.
How does mom and dad handling their baby girl getting criticized?
Well, their baby girl's all grown up, and they've been around this a long time, mm-hmm. and I think they have a good perspective on, you know, there will be times when everybody loves you, and there will be times when you have to make tough decisions and take criticism. They're very confident in that I'm grounded and centered, and that I have good judgment and that I make good decisions. I'll tell you a little story. When I was first running for office back in 2006, I was in a big field of candidates, mm-hmm. 17 people running for the same job. Mm-hmm. I was thought to be the front runner. Mm-hmm. So 17 people and me.
Mm-hmm. I mean, they all gunning it.
All
you.
Gunning for right. me. And I remember thinking after this particular debate, my mother was in the audience, oh, she must be just devastated by this. I wonder. I said, Mom, are you okay? And I looked over and she was kind of laughing and chuckling with everybody else. I said, mm-hmm. you okay? She said, oh, Mary, don't worry about that. They just, you know, don't worry about that. You just do what you have to do. Mm-hmm. And I think that is kind of her perspective now.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So in a time where there is so much negativity and hand-wringing and everybody talking so much about the media, by and large, is generally attracted to negative stories. Bad news sells, it seems, a whole lot better than good news. So to our viewing audience out there who are sitting here and wondering, you know, are Washington, D.C.'s best days ahead? What might you, as its leader, to say why Washington, D.C. remains to be a great place to live now and for the future?
Well, Washington, D.C.'s best days are clearly ahead. Our city is booming in so many ways. When people want $800, $1,000 a month, want to move to your town, mm-hmm. you're doing something right. Mm-hmm. When businesses want to locate here and are kind of knocking on your door instead of the other way around, you're doing something right. When we have record numbers of tourists coming to this town, we had our fifth record-breaking year just this past year, you know you continue to be doing something right. When the whole elected establishment is behind school reform and schools improving and the willingness to invest those dollars, you're definitely doing something right. And I have to tell you, I think even the press corps in Washington knows it. Mm-hmm. And they're pretty balanced too. And mm-hmm. so I'm always proud. And when I go to places all around the country and around the world, everybody knows the comeback story of Washington, D.C. and how it has been, and in some ways, very instructive for other cities.
Mm-hmm. Lastly, we're in the football season.
We are.
And the Washington, D.C. team, the team that represents the Washington, D.C. metro area. Mm-hmm. I don't say that R word.
Right.
I don't use that.
Right.
I think I'm supposed to pretend to be objective on all issues,
right,
on that one, I'm not.
Okay.
I don't like it. There's been rumors about the possibility that they want to leave Prince George's County and possibly come back into D.C. Do you take a position on them being able to do that? And do you put a condition on the name if they so desire to come here?
Well, I think that the team belongs back in Washington. It's mm-hmm. no secret. I've said that from the beginning. I also think it's no secret that they, you know, they're not, how should I say, they want a better stadium. Mm-hmm. And they want a better location mm-hmm. that their fans can get to more easily and all that. And we have the perfect location.
Yeah.
It's where they used to play. Mm-hmm. And so that is, I think there are a lot of conditions to that, however. Mm-hmm. And I'm not satisfied with them sticking to a name. And mm-hmm. I don't think that the kind of the weight and the momentum of change mm-hmm. is going to support them keeping that name. I really don't. Mm-hmm. But I think the big thing that we are concerned about in Washington is if we put another stadium at RFK,
right.
what other type of development can happen there?
Mm-hmm.
None of us is interested in a new stadium that looks exactly like the one
sure.
that's there, that's surrounded
sure.
by a sea of parking.
Yeah.
We would be more interested in an urban model
mm-hmm.
That had housing, that had play fields, which the neighborhood is very much interested in,
mm-hmm.
and that supported a mix of uses. So if we could come to some kind of development that looked like that, I would be very excited about it. But I'll tell you this, Rock, our timeline may be different than
mm-hmm.
Than the team's
mm-hmm.
Because we're going to have a brand new stadium for our soccer team.
Yeah.
Real soon.
Yeah.
And then we'll have an empty RFK stadium.
Mm-hmm.
Now, as mayor of the District of Columbia, I can't have an empty stadium there without a plan.
Yeah.
And so we're coming up with a plan that includes the team or doesn't.
Mm-hmm.
And then we'll move forward around that time.
Having you as
All
a
right.
guest tonight
Thank
is
you.
The Super Bowl of interviews.
Thank you.
Thank you
Thank
so
you.
Much,
Thanks,
Mayor,
Rob.
For being with us.
Thank you.
Folks, that wraps us for this evening. For information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. I'm Rock Newman. God bless you, and we'll see you the next time around. Go D.C.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.